Hello. In this video, we're going to go through the content that we'll cover in the second week of the course, and we continue discussing topics of chapter one of the textbook. So on the first week, we went over the more mathematical introduction, and now we're going to start discussing physics. So it will be a quick review of what you've seen in kinematics in previous introductory classes, but now we'll treat them a bit more formally from the point of view of using vectors and being rigorous in the mathematical treatment of position, velocity, and acceleration at vectors. So we're going to go today over this section 7, 8, and 9, which is a review of the basics of kinematics, and then in the next mini video on the second part of the week, we're going to discuss the last two chap sections of the chapter. I'm going to be using here a homemade document viewer, so maybe when I write the text, it will be not very clear, but I will scan, and you will see in the slides that go with this video, you can see a more clear version of what I write. So this will be posted in the SharePoint. And let me start with a story that I heard from a colleague who, when he became a professor, the first class he was assigned to teach was an introductory class, so Physics 145. And on the first day, he showed up in class assuming, okay, this is a calculus based. All my students are familiar with calculus and said, okay, we are going to start by defining the position of a vector. Sorry, a position of an object that with the variable x. And then we're going to work on kinematics. So kinematics is defining the position, the velocity, which is the rate of change of the position with time. So it's simply dx dt, the time derivative of x. And then the acceleration is the next variable, which is the rate of change of velocity with time. So it's dv dt or equal to ddt of velocities dx dt. And this is the second derivative of position with time. Right? And so these three equations define kinematics. This is all you have to know. It's easy. And you can imagine the result of that was a stampede, and I don't know, a third of the students dropped the class immediately and were really somewhat scared by this introduction. Which, of course, if you think back when you were probably taking, perhaps a student taking your first physics class and maybe not so familiar, still not so confident about your calculus levels, and you're presented with this, you might have might be a bit fearful about the course. But where was that person then recalibrated the way to approach introductory courses and found a way to ease the students into kinematics. But the point is correct. This is all it is to it, right? I suspect you remember from calculus that if you have a function f, and this is a function that depends on time, this is our f, and this is t. So you take the rate of time of the function, you look at in a time interval delta t, your function changes by some value delta f from the difference between the time at say at t2, or the value of the function at t2 and the value of the function at t1. So then the derivative is the limit when of this delta f divided by dt when the time interval delta t goes to a small number, 0. This is the derivative of f with respect to time. Sometimes if you use Newton notation, is f dot. If the position is well defined, the velocity and acceleration are simply the time derivative of the position. What you can do also with in kinematics is go backwards from acceleration to velocity and velocity to position, and we do that by integration. So for example, if acceleration is dv dt, then we integrate, we can write this as a dt is the differential of velocity, and we integrate from the v0 to v1 and t0 to t1, where v0 is the velocity at time t0 and v1 is the velocity at time t1. And this yields a familiar equation I'm going to flip this part here. V1 minus V0 equals A T1 minus T0, which typically is written as V1 or V of T equals A times T plus V0. If we take usually, we say that T0 is, we define it as 0. And if we integrate again, we get the equation for position as a function of time equals x0 plus v0 times t plus a over 2 t squared, which maybe a remark, in many cases, I mean, this applies only when acceleration is constant. It doesn't depend on t. Otherwise, the integral here will have to consider acceleration changing with time. So there are a few, you'll find a few problems throughout the class where actually this is not true. So we are gonna solve more general cases, and a common difficulty students encounter is in this class is sometimes applying this equation when you should actually solve the integral with a acceleration that depends on time. So here is our quick summary of what you saw in kinematics. And this chapter is going to be about kinematics. And then in chapter 2, just as a preview, we are going to go to dynamics, when we are going to discuss, well, why would the acceleration be what it is, or have different values as a function of time, and that's forces that act on your object and change its acceleration. So in our case, the summary of kinematics in three equations is simply is the same, but we will be mindful of treating the variables, the kinematic variables, as vectors. So here is using Cartesian coordinates, but we're going to see also the particular cases when, for example, we use polar coordinates where we have special considerations to deal with. So the velocity is again going to be the rate of change. Well, is the rate of change of the position, and the acceleration is the rate of change of the velocity with time. And now I'll go over in particular what we have to consider when we treat them as vectors. So let's start by defining the position vector. We're going to use R usually as the symbol for it. So we have our coordinate system, x, y, z, with a choice of origin. And let's assume we have some object in the point here where we have the coordinates x1, y1, and z1. So the position is the vector going from the origin to the point where I don't know, our object of interest is located, whatever it might be, your car. Right. So the position is not the most interesting vector because it depends on the particular choice of the coordinate system. If you have a different coordinate system, the position of this will be a different vector from the origin of the other coordinate system to here. So it's somewhat an arbitrary choice. The interesting one is the displacement, which is the changing position as the object moves to another point at a different time. So let's say if we move from here to a new position with coordinates x2, y2, and z2. Now we have a new position r2. And we'll define the displacement as the difference between the two positions. So S is equal to R position at point 2 minus position at point 1, or is a delta R. And this is a vector that is independent of the choice of coordinate system and has a bit more physical meaning than position. And you can look in the book. So in the book it explains or discusses in a bit more detail and shows a simple mathematical proof of why displacement is independent of the choice of coordinate system. So we have here an object. You can imagine it's initially at this point, and R1 is the position measured by this coordinate system. R1 prime is by the prime coordinate system, which are kind of translated by a vector capital R. But so this point has two different positions in the two different coordinate systems, but the displacement from this point 1 to point 2 is the same regardless of what coordinate system we use. Now, the velocity was the same, has the same definition as for the one-dimensional case, so it's a rate of change of position with time. So let's see how we do this with vectors. So now we have our object here at our, let's say, at a time t is at the point r of t. And then this will move following some trajectory. And at some later time, t plus delta t, it will be in a new point. And the position vector to that point is r of t plus delta t. See, this was our r1, this is r2. So our displacement, delta r, is r of t plus delta t, the position at a later time minus the position at the initial time. And the velocity is the time derivative of the position, which we defined as a limit, as the limit of delta r divided by delta t when we take small intervals delta t. And there are different ways to deal with this. For example, the book shows how to use the components of the vector to convert the this calculation into a set of scalar equations. This is discussed, for example, look at the this section of the textbook. You can write the components of the vector delta r, the displacement vector, and get the rate of change of the x component and the rate of change of the y component. Each of them are scalar equations. Or another way is calculated directly from here. The delta r, I didn't wrote it, but didn't draw it, but maybe I can use a different color. It would be like this. This is our delta r. So we can also get the velocity by writing R as the unit vectors, yj, let's say k hat. Right. So now then our velocity is ddt of x I hat plus y j hat plus z k hat. Okay, and then we can, well, this is the, what's the name of the property, distributive or associative? You might remember this better than me. So we can write this without any, upsetting any mathematician by splitting the x, y, and z parts and taking the derivative of each of them. And then from here, you can apply the chain rule. You have the derivative of product. So if we use the chain rule, this becomes, and let's do it only for this part. So we get that B equals dt of x I hat plus x ddt of the unit vector, the time derivative of I hat. This is the unit vector that points in the direction of our x-axis. So I hat gonna be like that. So for Cartesian coordinates, the unit vectors are constant. So they do not change. They always have the unit length, unit dimension, and they always point in the same direction. So any derivative of them with time is going to be zero. So I hat dt equals zero. And this might seem obvious, but when we see, for example, at the polar coordinates, some of the unit vectors do change with time, and you have to take that into account to calculate velocity properly. And it might sound like an extra complication, but it makes solving some particular, or not a particular, but a good number of problems in an easier way to use polar coordinates. So, but in that case, you have to be careful of including the component of the velocity that comes from the change of the unit vectors, the basis of your coordinate system. Now we are, this is going to be for the next part of, we'll worry about that in the next, the second part of the, of kinematics. For now, this is zero. So this, the contribution of this term is only dx dt. So this is the x component of velocity that you get when you do sort of the one-dimensional problem. So we have that the velocity in the end is dx dt I hat plus dy dt. The same is true for the j and k unit vectors. So we get this expression that we can, to simplify notation, dx dt, we can call it the vx, the x component of the velocity, and the same for the y and z components. And this is how we can deal with the velocity vector. And for acceleration, it's going to be the same. The acceleration is going to be the rate of change of velocity with time, which is ddt of vx I hat plus vy j hat, and so on. Which gives us an acceleration written in component forms, and ax I hat and the other terms, and this will look better when I scan things. Y k hat plus az, sorry, ay j hat, an AZK hat. So one final side, well, one side point, it's about trajectory. Let me define it a bit more carefully. So the trajectory is the set of all the points that the particle traces as it moves through space. So it's the path followed by the particle. So all the set of all the positions as a function of time. So, and there is a particular relationship between the trajectory. This would be this curve. So we have a position which is at time t here. Sorry, an object which is at time t at this, in the point pointed by the vector rt. And rt plus delta t is the position at a later time. And rt plus delta t prime prime is the position at subsequent times. So the, if you look at smaller and smaller delta t's, so the displacement vector is, are these vectors going from the point at time t to the position at rt plus some delta t. And as delta t goes to zero, you will see that the displacement becomes parallel to velocity. And gives the result that the velocity is always tangential to the trajectory at every point. And this is something to keep in mind that is useful to solve a number of problems. And it's sort of a general property of the velocity vector. So we saw how to obtain the velocity and acceleration by deriving from the position. Now we're going to go the other way and solve for the trajectory by integrating the acceleration. And we are gonna end up in the, well, kind of the vector form of the familiar results in one dimensions. So, so this equation, if we write it in component explicitly, showing explicitly the components of the vectors, we get something like this. We get this. And first thing, let me show you that this is actually equivalent to three scalar equations, which are this. So these two equations are equivalent, where we simply here we separate the, let's say, the x component of the acceleration is the time derivative of the x component of the velocity, and so on for the y and z. And we will get this by, we can prove that, for example, by multiplying, getting the scalar product of both sides by each of the unit vectors. So for example, here I just wrote this equation again, but now I just want to take the dot product with the same basis vector on each side, for example, j hat. So now this is taking the scalar product with j hat of this term and also of this term and of this term. So we know that I dot j hat equals to zero. And this is also k hat dot j hat. So the dot product with these two will be zero. The only one that is not zero is the j hat. So j hat dot j hat equals to one, right? So taking the dot product kind of takes out the a y term. So because of this, we get that a y on this side, and here the j dot j will be one, and this j dot I and j dot k is zero, so we get only this guy. So this is equals to the time derivative of the y component of the velocity, which is this guy. Right. So yeah, that justifies writing this as three scalar equations. And now this is the same case we had for the first encounter in kinematics in physics 145. So now that we have this, we can integrate as you did in the introductory classes. This is sort of the scalar equation. And let's put it in this way. We integrate velocity from V0 to V1, where velocity V0 and V1 correspond to the velocity at time T0 and time T1. And on the other side, we have the integral by putting the delta t differential to the other side. So we integrate as a function of time. And we can assume, if the more general case, the acceleration is not a constant, so will depend on time. So then we have to keep it inside the integral, and that will tell us that the v, so we have dy, let's say that time t1, minus by at time t0 equals to the integral t0 to t1 ay of t dt. Right. Or, yes. And there will be the same equation for Vx and Vz. So that gives us the result for the, now instead of T0, of T1, I'm going to use T. And V0 is the velocity at T0 plus integral from T0 to T of A of T prime dt prime. So that gives us the result for any time. And what we have here is a vector. So you have to, when you do the integral, you can integrate each of the components separately and get, that's usually the good trick to solve this. So these kind of problems. And you have to be careful always that if the acceleration depends, is a function of time, it's not constant, then you cannot take it out of the integration and get the usual equations for the constant acceleration motion. Although in some cases we'll see it, but yeah, you have to think if it applies or not. And then the same applies for the position. So the position comes from the integrating velocity. So the position as a function of, for any arbitrary time, will be the initial position plus the integral from time t0 to t of your velocity as a function of time. And that concludes our introduction to kinematics. And I'll leave you with a question that you have to answer on Monday. Here it is.